thought it would be, I know you've already had the materials list come up, but just tell you a little bit about what we're going to be doing today and show you some examples of some previous collages that I've made. So the idea of the workshop is that we're going to be looking at the ideas of language and images and shape and how they can come together to form a collage that relates to alternative ways of expressing either emotions or language or sentences or phrases that you feel have kind of struck a chord with you, for example. So for here's one example, which I made earlier, where I'm looking at the idea that it's this, words and language can come together in lots of different ways. They don't necessarily have to be sentences that make sense. They can just be a little bit poetic, a little bit more mysterious. And it's really up to you how you want to structure yourself and the words and the collages that you make today. So these are all kind of cutouts that I've done from different magazines, especially the words. And then the images are from the image pack that you've got there. So I'm gonna share my screen and I'm gonna share a few examples of some other visual artists that have used image and text in their practice before, just to give you some ideas of other ways in which you can approach this workshop or after the workshop as well. So bear with me one second, here we go. So you should be able to see my screen. And the artist that I'm gonna show you today, so the first one is an American artist called Jim Goldberg. He uses text and images as a way of inviting the people that he's photographing to express their emotions. So the whole project is premised on the movement of people to Europe through different routes, so migration, immigration, and also human trafficking. And this is the way that it gives the subject some empowerment in order to express what they're feeling, how they've kind of dealt with the situation. And it's a really simple technique where he's photographed them using a Polaroid and then he's offered them markers and pens to draw around and on top of the images. The next example is Shirin Neshat, who is an Iranian photographer. She often photographs women who are veiled, and she then inscribes Iranian poetry onto the hands, the faces, or the feet which aren't veiled. So it's this alternative way of looking at the ideas of identity, politics, poetry in her work. John Baldessari, this particular work is kind of where my Mountain of Salt series, which is what the workshop is inspired by, has come from in some ways. So although these appear as kind of banal or straightforward image, object, and text, collages, actually it's in this particular work that he made in the late 90s were inspired by Francisco Goya's etchings called The Disaster of War from the 1800s. It's a combination of these kind of violent depictions of words and how words were used in this particular series of etchings, but by extracting them and placing them with a really straightforward image of kind of flower pot or a paperclip, it really changes this idea of what you're looking at. And I think a lot of visual language and visual storytelling has this way of transforming once it's taken out of its original context and placed with something else to make you think a little bit more about what you're seeing. The next example is by Adam Brimberg and Oliver Channerin. And they've been making these poster works, which are taken, the pages are taken from copies of the International New York Times. And then they put different quotes or different ideas or different words with it as a way of reflecting the chronology of how they make their work at different moments. So what you see here is these ideas that the posters are almost a mirror to the practice that they're making at the time. Gillian Waring is, this is probably an iconic body of work that we can see here. So she made this in the early 90s and she invited and she stopped hundreds of passers-by in London and gave them a piece of white paper and a marker and asked them to express what they were feeling. And what's really interesting about this body of work is that she then photographed them again. And often there was a divide between what you were seeing on written on the actual placard itself and then the person that was showing it. So it's a lot about, you know, reflecting their innermost feelings, their innermost self to the camera in a quite a public way, but also in a quite a private way as well. So it's this idea that you're looking at street and studio photography within her works here. Barbara Kruger, this is quite an iconic work from the late 80s. And this particular piece of work that she made was used to challenge ideas of power and identity and sexuality. So this particular image, she overlaid an image and text, and it was in response to the Women's March on Washington in the late 80s in support of reproductive freedom. And it's quite an iconic image, which you may have seen, you know, used in different advertising campaigns. And I think Selfridges used something similar or did something similar with one of their advertising campaigns in order to strike a message that would be really quite powerful. And I think what's interesting here is the fact that you've got this kind of bold red behind the text, so it really sets it apart from the image itself, but it has this idea of layers. And I think that's something quite interesting when you're cutting out or tearing from your magazines or your newspapers, that actually might not need to cut out the individual letters. Sometimes using the whole piece of text with the paper behind it could actually be quite powerful as well. Sam Winston is an interesting letter artist, I would say. He isn't interested in how language can be a carrier of messages. He's interested in how the formation of individual letters or numbers can be used and adopted into a visual form. So he often uses the repetition of the same letters or words and different scales of them in order to create a distinct typography in which these symbols kind of turn into these expansive visual messages and images, which I think is a slightly different way of approaching this kind of idea of using visual art and language. Rachel Whiteread, I put this in there because I thought this particular series is a series of postcards. And what she does is she punches holes into the actual postcards themselves. And what happens is you create this depth and this different play on mark making and gesture. And if you think about cutting things out of images or tearing things out of images, what does that do when you're looking at the final image itself? And if you overlay that with visual language and text again, it changes the kind of meaning of what you're looking at. And the last example I'm going to show you is by American artist Lorna Simpson. She used these vintage copies of Ebony and Jet magazine, which were prevalent in the late 60s and 70s in America, all about Black culture and celebrating Black culture. And she cuts out the female figures like you see here and places it on a kind of canvas, which is completely bare. She then either uses watercolor or, like we see here, text and different compilations of text to create images that reflect or rebuild the hair of these women. And I think that's quite interesting as a way of celebrating the diversity of hair and these ideas of how different conduits can be placed on top of the image here as well. So I'm gonna stop sharing my screen, and then I think we can kind of go into some making. And obviously if there's any questions about anything that I've shared with you, please do pop it in the Q&A and I'd be more than happy to answer them. Okay, so here we are. I'm gonna move my pre-made collages aside for now. And I think what we're gonna do is break this up into two parts. I think if we start, for me, when I'm making my collages, I often start by finding the language first. That's often where the process and the mark making and the work starts. And once I have that, I then begin to look at the images that I have and see what works as a pair or what works as a kind of symbology here. So I'm gonna move some stuff around. I'm gonna use scissors, but obviously if you don't have scissors, you can tear out from the magazine or the newspaper. And as you'll see here, I just have a selection of stuff that was lying around. So from the Evening Standard, which I picked up yesterday, to the Metro, and then I think this came through the letterbox. So the materials I have are just things that I've come across, not necessarily found in that sense. And so I'm gonna start here. I've kind of gone through this particular magazine. And for me, this idea of the injection of hope, obviously it relates to the vaccine and the pandemic and the kind of world we're living in right now. But I think also when it's paired with an image, it could be quite something quite interesting. So I'm gonna cut that out and I'm gonna pop that on the side for now. The language that you kind of can use, it doesn't have to be English. You could be thinking in symbols. You could be thinking of a different language. It doesn't also have to be cut out from a magazine. You could have poetry that you're inspired by that you want to write down. You also don't have to cut out anything or tear anything out. You could take your markers and use those and write something on top of the images as well when we get to that point. So just have a think. And go through the materials that you have and see how you feel about what you want to do with your collage. So I'm going to pop that on the side.
Bindi, do you collect things to keep for future work, or do you tend to make this kind of work as and when you find things that are particularly interesting or that strike you?
I actually often collect a lot of stuff. So with the mountain of salt body of work, I was keeping a notes on my phone. So if ever I saw something or read something or heard something that was particularly, it kind of inspired me in some sort of way or kind of resonated, I would often write it down and store it in there. And I have this document which just keeps evolving, and new sentences, new phrases, new words are constantly being added to it. And so then I have that as my kind of, I guess, archive of language, you could say. And then I often go back to that. And it's the same with images. I've been collecting images, whether they're buying them from eBay or cutting them out of magazines, since for the last 10 years. And that's often where I go back to begin making new work from that. So I often go back to my archive of these, whether it's my own images that I've taken or found or bought, I kind of go back to all of that and have another look at it and see what's there, what's happening, what's kind of striking something within me. And then I'll often use that as a starting point and begin to make new work from there. I think when you're looking through any kind of text and things like that, it's often interesting to see how they've used typography. So for example, in a newspaper, how they use it within advertising and the different fonts they use, or how they use it to kind of, you know, catch your attention, and how they use color as well. Like here, for example, you know, with the red background to kind of really, you know, strike you or to take you. And I think that's what in this particular work I'm interested in. It's like how they're using language, how they're constructing these words, how they're constructing these sentences, and what they're trying to say to you, and what they're trying to, you know, how they're trying to make you feel within it. You know, this for example is something I'm gonna cut out. COVID in retreat. The cutting doesn't have to be perfect either. It can, you know, there's no right or wrong way when you're taking these kind of bits and pieces out of the newspaper or a magazine, or you're ripping it. There's no right or wrong way. You can always finesse it later if you wanted to. Quite like the color behind the text here. So I'm gonna just take this out. When I'm picking language, often it's what the words are doing and how they've been put together that I'm drawn to. I quite like when words are a little bit more, or sentences are a little bit more mysterious, because I think that adds a different depth, especially when they're extracted from their context as well. So I'm gonna just take off those little bits there. Okay, so I've got three words, or three sets of phrases that I'm gonna start with. And so if you guys are happy to move on, we can kind of look at the image pack and then the images that I've got here, and maybe begin to think about what could work as a pairing. So I've got the fear of guilty love, COVID in retreat, and the injection of hope. And I think they're three very different, but kind of very resonant messages here. So I have a pile of dirty dishes, maybe not. I think this could be quite an interesting pairing, the fear of guilty love and all this food on the table. I mean, you know, who doesn't like cakes and pastries and things like that? So maybe this could work. I'm just gonna move some stuff around. I'm gonna hold on to this one for a second. I'm not sure about that image. Often when I'm thinking about image pairings, it's about what's happening here as well as what's happening with the words. And they don't often have to mirror one another, but it's quite interesting when they're slightly ajar, because I think it makes whoever's looking at the collages think a little bit more about what they're seeing and what they're reading. and how they kind of work together.
Had a question here, Bindi. Someone's asked, how archival would pieces like this be? The ink might not be very light fast. Do you do anything to your images to make them last longer?
Yeah, I mean, it depends on, I was talking actually to my partner about light fastness this morning. It's quite funny that that's come up. The pigment markers that I use, if I'm going to make physical collages and I'm going to write on top of them, you can get materials that have light fastness qualities and are acid free, for example. So with the, you know, Pritt Stick, for example, I'm not sure is archivally friendly, but you can get like glues that are neutral in acid and alkaline, so pH balanced, from different art shops and things like that. It depends. I mean, you know, when they say archival, it's often 50 plus years worth of, you know, they're going to stay with you. But I think if you're trying things out, it's okay to just use what you have. And then if you're thinking of taking it to the next level, then of course, you know, invest in those like bits and pieces of materials. The actual collages that I made for the series, and I think I have an example here, were actually made digitally. So you can kind of see, I put the whole piece together on a computer, and then it's printed on an archival paper. So there's lots of different ways in which you can do it. You can often, you know, if, for example, you're interested in the idea of layers and flattening the layers, so you could always scan your collages after, and once they're printed onto a paper that is more archivally friendly, that will obviously help the preservation. You wouldn't necessarily have the textures and things like that from physically collaging, but there's also something quite interesting that happens when they are scanned back in as well. So, okay. There's maybe something here. I'm gonna start putting together my pieces. I think I'm gonna start with this one. Although you have this kind of white border around the image, you don't necessarily have to keep that. You can either, you know, draw on top of it. You could also cut out or tear the edges if you want more of a square, very kind of tight crop. I'm going to leave it there for now and I'm going to see how I go. I don't quite have a Pritt Stick. I have something similar to a Pritt Stick. So whatever glue you have, use it. I often work quite intuitively with the text. So I'm going to look at where this could work really interestingly. It could be at the top, it could be at the bottom, it could be in the middle. There's no right or wrong way, I think, when you're making collage. It's what feels right and what looks right visually for you when you're working with all the components. For me, I think I'm gonna pop it here because I think there's something quite interesting happening with her arm outstretching towards a plate. And I think it's quite nice that the text is almost leading you up in some ways.
Just to say to everyone, we have these images available to download at hospital-rooms.com. If you click on Digital Art School and you visit the program and the resources, you can see all of these images that Bindi has put together. So if you're following the workshop later on, you can download them from there.
So what do I want to do next? I know you guys have some, if you've got the packs that were sent out, you've kind of got these smaller round dots. You can also cut the round to make a shape, a different shape. If you don't like the kind of shape that's here, you can also rip or cut into squares or triangles or anything you want to do. It's a kind of free form. You work with what works best for you and the image. And often what I do with the kind of colored dots or stickers is think about, you know, it's not just about the color of them. It's also about thinking what the meaning is. So for example, in the collages that I've been making, these squares are symbolizing unity and totality because of the way that it's structured. It's quite a rigid shape. Whereas, you know, the circles, for example, are all about unity and togetherness because it is this kind of round circle. So it's more about the symbology of the shapes and what they're doing, which I think is interesting. So how often I place them onto the images where I want people to look further to see what else is happening in the images. So with this one, I want to kind of draw your eye towards this group of people over here. And so I think I'm going to put one circle here. I choose to play with scale in the shapes that I use, just because I think it offers a little bit more, focus around the image, and it's not all the same shape as well, which I think often helps to break up some of the, you know, some of the busyness of what's going on. I have a lot of different colors. You can use what you want. If you don't like the colors that you have, I've also tried coloring onto a piece of paper, so using markers or paint, and then kind of tearing and cutting around that. So it's a kind of free form, what you want to do and what you want to choose from it. So I think with the purple, I want something that's a bit more striking. So I'm going to try these highlighter yellow colors as well.
Bindi, when you're selecting your images, is it always important for you that they're black and white? Do you ever use color imagery?
Yeah, I mean, I have previously, but for this particular body of work, as a way of almost, I guess, re-archiving the images, I've cropped them and all to the same size, and they're all black and white. So they're all treated in the same way. So it has, I guess, you know, it then doesn't differentiate between whether it was a 60s Polaroid or a 35mm kind of family snap, that all treated the same way. So when you then look at it as a new body of work, they have a different layer of archiving that's happened to them, which I think is what makes it really interesting. I often start with, I think I've said this, with the words first, and then I look for the images as a way of pairing them. And often that helps to just not over collect or not over kind of take lots of materials and then not use them. So that's often the kind of process in which I go through. I think this one is done, but I like the idea of the frame. And so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna just give it something to hold on to. Sorry about the sound. So in order to see if I want to crop this, I'm just going to fold the top and have a look. You see, I think already just by folding that white edge off, it really kind of draws you back into the image a bit. And I think I'm just going to fold all these edges. So you don't necessarily have to cut them off. You could also fold them over as well if you prefer. It also doesn't have to be perfectly straight. I quite like it when it goes a little bit asymmetrical, and it's not quite aligned in many ways. Here we go, one collage. The reason I pulled this image, I'm going to move on to a second one. The reason I pulled this image is because I was talking to a friend and she said something really interesting. Rest doesn't feel restful. And I thought as a pairing, this could work really well. And so rather than cutting out from a magazine a pre-existing kind of sentence or word, I'm going to write on top of the image, because I think that would create something really different. The typography that you use can be anything. You could try bubble writing, you could do capital letters, you could have it in sentence case. It's kind of, I quite like this idea that it's quite bold and quite out there. And I want to use a color for the text as well. So I think I'm gonna choose a blue.
We've had a question, Bindi, about what brand of pens are you using?
Oh, these are These are Winsor & Newton pigment markers. I don't know if you can see that. Is that upside down? That is upside down, sorry. There you go.
Pigment markers.
I got these, I think I got these on Amazon for £30, but there's about 36 different colors in there. So there's plenty of choice. At the moment, like in other collages, I've been using pastels as well, or crayons, which are quite fun actually. To use because of their wax properties on them. It does something quite interesting when you then try and paint over them, if you're going to paint over them as well. So I think I'm going to do a combination. So I collected these stickers. I bought a Moleskine diary, and often in the diaries, they give you these stickers. I think you're meant to mark a page with, like, when you've been out for a meal or you've gone to the theater and all of that. But obviously we're not doing any of that right now. So I'm gonna take the letters that are in there and I'm gonna start with those. And these are just stickers. And then I'm gonna fill in some of it with some written text as well, just to see what happens. It's all kind of experimentation. There's no right or wrong with it. Sometimes it really works, and then some, or it does something really interesting that you like, and then sometimes it doesn't, and that's okay as well. Hope I don't run out of letters before I get to the end of this. I'm working with obviously letters and the English language, but you know, often you can make up symbols, you can make up signs as well. You don't have to follow this method. You can kind of do what you would like to do with it. I often see these kind of works as a kind of expression of how you're feeling, and how, like for me, I use this type of collage, especially with the mountain, like the bigger body of work, Mountain of Salt, as a way of dealing with everything going on around us. So, you know, I was really struggling, I think, at the beginning of the first lockdown, as to like knowing how we're meant to behave, what we're meant to do, how we're meant to act in this kind of space where we've never experienced this kind of pandemic situation before. And so I was using the way of collecting language and putting these collages together just as a way for me to deal with my emotions and have something physical in which to express it in. And so this is obviously one way of doing it. You don't have to do it like this. You can, it's really kind of interpretation of what you want to do and how you want to you know, show your either emotions or your feelings, or you know, just a collection of words. And for me, this has really helped just in terms of dealing with the whole, I guess, situation in a very small way. So I'm going to move on to stickers. And I think I quite like the blue palette, and I might stick with that. So I'm just going to see what I have. Gold is also quite nice. So I often use three shapes, maybe. Sometimes if I'm feeling more adventurous, I put maybe six or seven on there. It's kind of just very intuitive as to what's going on in the image. Often with an image like this, where there's a lot of similar things going on, I might use more kind of shapes and stickers in order to kind of lift it a little bit, and just kind of make sure that people are looking around what's going on here. Like, you know, the pile of mattresses, this kind of wooden structure at the top. as a way of just drawing yourself around the image a little bit more. I think in a similar way, I might use a border. I quite liked what happened when I did it with this one. So I think I'm going to do that again.
I think what will be interesting, Bindi, is because you've provided the images to everyone in the image pack, is seeing different interpretations of the same image that come through when people upload their work after the session.
Absolutely. I think that's the bit I'm most looking forward to, just to see how people have taken the images. Because also I think all the images that I think I've given you, well, I think all of them have been used in the actual main body of work that I've made around this. So, you know, it's the same images I've used in the same way in terms of the kind of cropping and the treatment of them. But it's always interesting as a starting piece to see what people come back with and how they use it and what they do. I was also thinking earlier today that, you know, it'd be interesting if people started kind of taking elements of one image and putting it on top of another and seeing what also happened there as well. Like, it's kind of, yeah, it's a completely, collage is one of those ones where it's, I think, one of the most forgiving art forms there is, because if you don't like something, you can paste something on top of it or just take it out completely. And then it often creates something really interesting on top of the image as well. If there's something missing or something's been put on top and the layers and things like that is what I quite enjoy about this process.
We're coming into the last 10 minutes of the session, actually. So it would be great if anyone on the Q&A wants to drop a note as to where they're joining us from today, or if they have any questions for Bindi about the process. Are you going to do one more with us?
Yes. Yeah, I can do one more. I'm gonna go light speed. Okay, I like this. I think this one I'm gonna leave it with the white, actually. Put down the scissors. Okay, I think that's quite nice, actually. Right. The last one is two. What do you guys think? COVID in retreat or injection of hope for this one?
We'll see if anyone puts it in the Q&A what they think, and then we can go with that one. We've got people joining us from Florida. Hello.
Oh, wow.
Florida. We have people joining us from Norwich, a little bit close to home. And we've got hope, two votes for hope.
Two votes for hope. Hope it is. There we go. I'm going to actually split the text up a little bit here. So although I cut it out as one long block, I'm going to see what happens if we just make it a little bit slimmer along these edges so that the cats really stand out. This was one of the first actual images I found on eBay, and I was so drawn to it because it's this kind of mystery of what these cats are doing and this kind of world that's in the middle of them. And it is just a globe that you would kind of, I think it's quite a 90s thing to have in your house, you know, one of those like light up globes. But the fact that these two cats look like they're either fighting over it or they're kind of, you know, playing with one another, it's it is one of the ones that drew me in quite quickly.
Just to say, we've got more people joining us. We've got patients on Avocet Ward in Ipswich. Hello from South Wales, North Cornwall, Hertfordshire, Sheffield.
It's a lot of people.
St Andrews, Scotland.
Well, thank you all for coming. Oh no, I've done that the wrong way around. Whoops, that's okay. Okay, let's see. I got a bit carried away with the glue there. try something a little bit different with this one. There's one. So back to my stickers. Ooh. A little bit of mirror there. I think that's too much. I'm going to go to the border again because I quite liked what happened with the other two. My markers are slightly dried up. But you don't want to use markers, you can also use paint around and on top of the images as well. And I think what's nice about the pigment markers is actually you can wet them a bit like watercolour and move the colour around a little bit on there. So
I'll just share some comments that we've had here. Really lovely comment. My car broke this week and has made me become really resourceful with what's around me. I'm using a car dealership brochure, boring, which is what was lying around, but the words I've picked are so personally meaningful to how I am today. It's made me realize that we can use anything around us and totally change it with focus. Thank you.
Oh, that's really nice. Well, I'm glad that the, you see, inspiration strikes anyway, even in a car dealership brochure.
And just some more people joining us. We've got hello from Dubai, from East London, from Camberwell, Ladywell.
Amazing. Well, I'm pleased that you've all managed to join and I hope you've enjoyed the workshop today. So I think I'm gonna have a look at what we've I've done today, at least. So we have the injection of hope. We have rest doesn't have to be restful. Excuse my messy workplace here. And then we have the fear of guilty love as a set there. I think there's something quite interesting. And you know what's actually interesting about this particular image? I did another one before. And you see the meanings are so different. And it changes. So I'm really interested to see what you guys have done with your collages and your images, because I think everyone will have something slightly different to work with here.
Amazing. Thank you so much, Bindi. Just reading these last few comments. We've really enjoyed this so far. Thank you. Great workshop. Looking forward to looking up more of your work online later. Just another one person saying it's harder than it looks. So maybe to practice, but thank you so much, Bindi. That was so much
fun to
watch. And Louis, I wonder if you can just switch up the slideshow for us. Great. So big thanks again to Bindi for such a fun workshop. Just a reminder that this whole session, the recording will be online tomorrow on our YouTube channel. Just search for Hospital Rooms. We will also be releasing a sort of short tutorial of this video that we'll be uploading in a couple of weeks. And if you'd like to find out more about Hospital Rooms, you can have a look on our website. And we are an arts and mental health charity that transforms inpatient mental health units with contemporary art. And we were very happy to work with Bindi a couple of years ago on a unit. So you can look at all of our past projects on there. We're also on Instagram. So that's @_hospitalrooms. And if you would like to share any of the work that you've made in today's session, you can go on our website and there is a link to upload to our Dropbox folder. And you can upload works anonymously or with your name or with the name of your unit. And we'll be uploading those all to our online gallery. So I would just like to say a big thank you again to Bindi and really hope that you can join us next week, where we will be doing memory landscapes with Karen Hall. And you can sign up for that on our website via Instagram, or you can sign up for our Digital Art School mailing list, which is also on our website, a link, and you will be emailed every Monday with details of our upcoming workshops. So thanks, Jen and Louis, for joining me today. And also big thanks to Bindi for such a fun workshop. And thank you to you for joining us. It's been a really great session. Thanks, everyone. Bye.